Bonjour.
Oh, wrong country. Hello, everybody. My name is Daniel, and I've never been to anywhere on this continent before, so first off, thank you very much to the organizers of DevOpsDays Cape Town for inviting me down. This is just fantastic. Since it's the first DevOpsDays that's being held here, I was asked to do something a little bit different from what I'm normally doing, technical talks, and get really to the essence of what DevOps is. So what we're going to go through over the next 30, 35 minutes is a little bit about the history of DevOps, where we are now, what it is, some of the terminology, some of the characters involved, and then kind of where we're going from there. In order to set up the rest of the next 2 days, there's going to be a lot of learning, a lot of growing. So this is just to sort of ground us and give us a common framework to speak from. So where are we going? How did we get here? A little bit about me, just for context. This is weird. That's my name. That's my Twitter handle. That's my blog. And that's the company I work for. I will have the slide again at the end because my Twitter handle is terrible. And everybody gets it wrong the first time, including me. Feel free to follow me on Twitter. Feel free to engage me on Twitter. That's how I like to communicate. So there you go. Again, just for context, I've been in the industry for about 20 years. So I've been doing the DevOps for a little while now. There you are. So what is DevOps? Well, before we can talk about what it is, it's important to talk about what it isn't. All right? So what I'd like to do, first off, is to dispel some DevOps myths. Okay? Now, this is actually a subset of Seth Vargo's seminal post on the topic, 10 DevOps Myths. I think Seth is actually at this conference. He's speaking tomorrow. So he's not here yet? Okay, well, he will be here. And definitely go up, harass him, ask him every question, tell him I said it's okay. So we're going to go through a couple of them. It's just a subset. I forgot to hit the timer. Can you tell me when I got like 20 minutes, 15 minutes? It's fine. Yeah, okay, cool. Scrum, Agile, Kanban. I'm sure you've heard of these things. All right. These are all good, but they're not DevOps. All right. These are process methodologies. They can be used in a DevOps environment. All right. These are just ways to build software or do things. They are neither sufficient nor necessarily necessary to do the DevOps. They do complement each other. A lot of times in a DevOps environment, you will see these techniques being employed, but they themselves are not DevOps. And the reason I point this out is because I've been to a lot of environments, I've spoken with a lot of people, and I say, are you doing the DevOps? Oh yeah, we're doing the DevOps, we have a Kanban board. Whoa, that's good, right on. So how exactly is the CAMS working out for you? The what? Exactly. These are all excellent, and they're all part of a solid approach, but they're not DevOps. Which leads me to the second point. There are no magical tools just for DevOps, despite what the vendors will tell you. Okay? There are no magical tools just for DevOps. You can't buy it in a box. There's not some piece of software that's going to do it for you. No? Okay. Some piece of software that's going to do it for you. There is something called the DevOps tool chain, which you may have heard of. We'll get to that a little bit later. But it's not a tool set. It's not a specific item. So there are no magical tools just for DevOps. It does not exist. Okay? Another thing it's not is this. It's not this. I like this, but this is not this. Another thing it's not is this. All right, the cloud is just other people's computers, okay? It's not DevOps, although we do tend to use it. This is not DevOps. So what is it then? Well, let's start by talking about the problem that it was intended to solve, all right? For a particular management style or for a solution to exist, there had to have been a problem. So what was the problem? And to do that, we need to go all the way back in time, eons and eons ago, to that dark age, 2008. Whew, I know, forever ago. In 2008, at an Agile conference, a man by the name of Patrick Dubois, and actually I'm gonna pause right there very quickly, I'm gonna drop some names over the next couple of slides. I do so only to give you context. In any sort of solutions environment, you're gonna come across the tastemakers and the thought leaders and the people who are proposing the ideas. So I'm gonna drop a couple of names as we go through here to give you an idea of the sorts of people that you might like to be doing some follow-up reading on, the people who are producing quality literature on the topic, the people that you can be learning from online, so on and so forth. Don't worry about memorizing the names or catching them right now. I've actually got some slides at the end that are the names and the Twitter handles, and you can take pictures of those. So don't worry about recording them as I'm talking. A guy by the name of Patrick Dubois, a nice Belgian man, presented at an Agile conference a talk entitled Agile Infrastructure. Agile Infrastructure. The central thesis of this presentation was how to extend agile dev processes to IT and ops. Distilled even further than that, the central thesis was more communication. How do we get these two teams that are sometimes quite far apart, either physically or procedurally, to be speaking to each other? It didn't have a word, it didn't have a name. So the best thing he came up with is agile infrastructure. It wasn't a great name, but there you go. Another man by the name of Andrew Clay Schaefer, currently works for Pivotal, if I'm not mistaken. And this is perhaps untrue, but what I was told was that Andrew and Patrick had a conversation after the chat, after the presentation, and they came up somewhat sarcastically with a portmanteau. Well, how do we get dev and ops to talk to each other? What if there was, I don't know, an engineer called a DevOps engineer? And then we wouldn't need dev or ops anymore. What a great idea. From that somewhat sarcastic conversation, the term DevOps was born. Now, is it the best word to describe what we want to talk about? No, but it's a word. So now we have DevOps. And that's where it comes from. So at its core, at its most essential, at its most raw, basic interpretation, what does DevOps define? People. DevOps is people. Bold, crazy, I know, right? It was about getting devs and ops to speak to each other, and more broadly, it was about breaking down those barriers to communication within an organization. That's the essential element of DevOps, okay? So for the next couple of days, everything you're talking about, you're gonna be learning about some very interesting things about code review and how to use the HashiCorp tools and in the open sessions, and there's gonna be a lot of talk about a lot of things. But try to think about it through the lens of this basic primal definition that DevOps is about people, first and foremost. So we talk about breaking down barriers to communication within an organization. What are those barriers? These are the barriers. All right, silos. I like the word silos, and this comes up a lot in DevOps literature. You see this word time and time again. And it defines these strong vertical chains of information, right? Where you might have an office of the COO, and underneath the COO you have like a VP of desktop, and underneath VP desktop you have director of printers, and underneath the director of printers you've got the manager of ink. Okay. These strong silo chains of information and process, and within the silo everything works really nicely. I'm supposed to at any rate. But there's no communication outside of it. There's no crosstalk. So the manager of ink goes, well, this printer's out of ink. I guess we should put more ink in it. But never tries to figure out why the printer's out of ink. Are we printing too much? Is there another team that's using it? Too much or not enough? I'm refilling ink when it doesn't need to be refilled? Is that effective? Because there's no communication. I'm, of course, using a bit of a flippant example, but you get the idea. So DevOps was designed and still functionally exists today to solve this problem. The idea of organizational silos. How do you get these disparate, vertically aligned groups to work together more efficiently to share that information? I'm sure we've all worked in environments similar to this one, full of unhappy people. All right, we've got devs in one, ops in another, marketing in yet another. It could be anyone. Communication is bad. Cooperation's worse. Nobody's happy. How do you go from this to this? This, by the way, is just an excuse to use emoji. I love emoji. These people are super happy. The one on the far side can't even contain it anymore. It's amazing. Try to do something in your life that makes you this happy. It's incredible. I feel like this every day. DevOps. That's not true. There you go. So how do you go from this to this? I'm going to let you in on a little secret. The secret sauce that makes DevOps so good. It's an acronym. I know as technical people, we love acronyms. This is a good one. CAMS. C-A-M-S. It's one of my favorites. Has anybody seen this acronym before? I'm hoping. Couple? No? Oh, good. You're in for a treat. CAMS is the acronym. Block it off. Memorize it. This is the one. Let's walk through each of these letters. C is for culture. All right? What is culture? Culture is, definition, but culture is the shared mores and expectations and the social contract between any group of people. Right? That's culture in a nutshell. Now, if there are any people here of sociology degrees, or fine. All right? I just mangled that definition. I get it. But the whole idea is that culture is a reciprocal relationship between how people communicate and how people expect to be communicated with, and all of the baggage that comes along with that, okay? When taken within the context of DevOps, it's about people and process. Remember, DevOps is people? So culture defines that, people and process. In other words, how do we get people to work together and drive from there? The needs drive the tools, not the other way around. You see this all the time, and I've seen it all the time, I've been guilty of it, where we go, oh, we've got this whiz-bang new tool, it's gonna be amazing. Whether it's a configuration management thing or some sort of continuous development tool, deployment methodology, and now we have to adapt all the humans to it. That sucks. All right, it doesn't work. People should drive computers, not the other way around. At least that's how I feel. And that's the central thesis of CAMS, and again, pretty core to DevOps. Some of the people who've been doing very interesting work in the culture space, okay, are Gene Kim. He's a fellow out of California. He's written a couple of books on the topic, most notably a work of fiction. It's not going to win Pulitzer Prize anytime soon, but it's called The Phoenix Project. It's an okay book, and it's a really interesting way to explain DevOps through prose, through story. So again, I'm going to put the names and everything at the end, so don't worry about it. But if you haven't read The Phoenix Project and you've got a weekend to kill, it's not bad. Another person doing some interesting work in the space is Sabine Bernecker-Bendixson, who recently had a name change. Whoops, I don't know her new last name, sorry. Who's been talking and tweeting and writing a lot about culture and the context of getting people to work together in communication. So definitely follow that. The A is for automate. All right, automation is key. I said earlier that DevOps is not about tools. Okay, maybe it's a little bit about tools. All right, just a little though. Okay, why? But the important thing is to think about why do we want to automate? Has anybody here got a process inside of their environment which is automated? Okay, everyone here is raising their hands. Because if you've turned on a computer, something is automated, right? But why do we want to automate things? Why do we want the computer to do stuff that a human would normally be doing? Well, there's a lot of reasons. But the one I like is that when you have human beings doing rote, recipe-based work, those aren't people anymore. Right? Those are machines. And machines aren't very good at coming up with new ideas. Machines aren't very good at driving the business in new and exciting directions. So for me, at the very least, the core of automation, again, is people. How do we free up people from the rote repetition of going through recipes? Excuse me. And get them to actualize, both professionally, personally, as well as through the organization, through the business. That's why we automate, all right? Is to fully unlock human potential, not the other way around. One of the other people who's been doing some very, very interesting work in the automation space, a man by the name of Jez Humble, been talking a lot about automation and its value within the human context. And again, I'll put that up at the end. So again, A in CAMS is for automate. Why do we automate? To unlock human potential, right? That's at the core of DevOps. So far, so good. I'm not going too fast. Sometimes I talk too fast. It's fine? Okay, great. The next M in CAMS is measure, all right? Measure everything always. And this isn't just things like disk space, although you should definitely measure disk space. That's important. Bad things happen when disks fill up. So I work for Mozilla. We make a product called a web browser. It's called Firefox. Now, I'm not going to ask for a show of hands on who uses Firefox, because the last time I did that, it made me sad. But a part of Firefox is the add-ons infrastructure, where you can go in and you can download plugins, and there's, well, basically Adblock. That's the one you're downloading. That's a web page. It's not built in to Firefox. It's a web interface. It looks like it's the web browser, but it's not. If the computers in the cloud serving that web page have disks, and they do, and those disks fill up with logs because a new version of Adblock got released, and everybody's downloading Adblock, and those computers fail, the browser stops working. You can't even open it, in theory. The important thing is to measure. Measure everything always, okay? But beyond measuring computer stuff, measure people stuff, all right? Always come back to that. What do I mean by measure people stuff? Key performance indicators. Now, there's a whole talk you can do just on that, but to sum it up, the key performance indicators are the nuts and bolts of your organization. I tend to say company, but really it's more than that. What are the numbers, the raw numbers, those pieces of data that decide the success or failure of your organization? Now, if it's a business, it could be selling the widgets or signing up the subscribers. If you're in government, it could be ensuring that a greater number of people have access to a given service. If you're in academia, it could be the number of papers getting published or the number of pipelines getting created. I don't know, all right? The KPIs are going to be per organization. The reason you want to measure those alongside your disk space usage is because it tells a story, right? There's a relationship between the infrastructure that's making the organization go and what the organization is doing. Remember, it comes back to that communication, right? Normally, these are siloed things. They don't talk to each other. Bring them together. Find the story. Find the lines that bring those key performance indicators into your infrastructure. Have a more holistic understanding of what the organization is doing and where it's going. Here I've got the subtitle. If it moves, graph it. The subtext there is even if it doesn't move, you should still graph it. Because when it does move, you're going to want to know about it. Someone who's been doing some interesting work in this space is Catherine Daniels over at Etsy. Just amazing work on monitoring and measuring and how to interpret data. Etsy is phenomenal for monitoring and measuring, and she's been really driving that. So look out for anything that she's writing. It's amazing. The S is for share. Now, this comes at the end. Primarily because if you move the letters around, it forms the word scam, which we don't want to talk about. So we put the S at the end, and it sums up, in some ways, ties together the first three. If it's good enough for the scientific method, it's good enough for you. God, that's what I should have put there. All right. Sharing is a big part of the scientific method, and the scientific method is the fundamental element that drives our entire industry. right? We're supposed to be computer scientists and engineers, and we use computers, and computers have electricity in them. Why do we have electricity? The scientific method. So if it works for science, it can work for us. The whole idea of sharing is a feedback cycle. Remember I was talking about the measuring and the automation and the unlocking of human potential? Why do we do that? It's in order to create new information. Data should be shared, information wants to be free. The idea of sharing, again, is to break down those silos. Even when it's painful, especially when it's painful. Marketing has an idea for a really cool campaign that they want to do, and they don't bother talking to the infrastructure team until the day of, and then it explodes. Happens all the time, right? It's no one's fault. It's a culture issue. And the way we solve that is through sharing. At its most primal level, get everyone involved. Teams have daily stand-ups or have a weekly stand-up. Bring outside interests in there. Marketing's got a stand-up, get an infrastructure person in there. Front-end's got a stand-up, get a back-end person in there. Just make sure that there's a free flow of information, internal wikis, Slack, but not like the horrible 500-channel Slack with like the 9 organizations. Try to pare that down and just go, these are our interest groups. And again, there's a whole talk there about just how to use Slack. Oh my God. All right, sharing, feedback cycle. Get everyone involved to the best of their capacities. Now, we're not talking about cross-training everybody to do everything. We're just talking about making people aware of what other teams are doing. That's a critical element of it. Two big names talking about and working in this space are John Willis and Bridget Cromout, who's also involved in DevOpsDays. So follow them on Twitter, read their blog posts, books, everything's amazing, okay? So talking about CAMS then, those are the four elements of CAMS. Those are the essential elements, if you will, of DevOps. When we talk about what DevOps is, we're talking about executing on CAMS. Now, each of those elements works together in harmony. All right, it's a symbiosis. They all feed into each other. Each one's important. Without all four, it's a waste of time. You can't just do one. You can't even really just do two. It doesn't work. Maybe you could just do three, I don't know. But really, you want to do all four. You could automate everything, but then not share everything and not measure everything. What's the point of that? Or you could talk up culture. We have radical transparency, and everything's amazing, and you can have unlimited vacation. But none of that's actually true because we haven't implemented everything else. Right? You have to do all four, and it's hard. And you need the top-down desire to do it. Side note, and I get this question all the time, how do I do DevOps at my company? Like, you know, you're a coder or a programmer or somebody, I want to do DevOps, it sounds really good. How do I do that? And I go, well, you probably can't. Sorry, okay? Because it's an organization-wide thing. You need to get buy-in, and that's hard. And that would be a really, really good subject for an open space, either this afternoon or tomorrow afternoon, is how do you drive DevOps adoption within an organization? Very interesting topic. But again, all of them work together in harmony. You have to have all of them, or don't bother. Now we're going to get into a little bit of something else. Is this. Now, I mentioned that there's an acronym. CAMS, and that these four letters are at the heart of DevOps. Well, because it's DevOps, there has to be a disagreement on something, right? It's about people and people argue, right? People have debates, people get mad, people don't want to agree on stuff. And this is one of the things that DevOps people don't agree on, all right? There is maybe a letter L? Why is there a letter L? Letter L. And why is it controversial? Well, L is for lean, not as in leaning in, but lean the software development methodology. Now, a lot of DevOps thought leaders, tastemakers, so on and so forth, as well as a lot of vendor people who are trying to sell you DevOps, whatever the heck that means, are lean practitioners, all right? So there's a lot of overlap in blog posts, talks, presentations, so on and so forth. When you talk about DevOps, they talk about lean, so they jam an L in there. Now, DevOps can make lean adoption within an organization more efficient, all right? And don't worry if you don't know what lean is, it's cool. It's a way to make programs. There you go. So there's a lot of overlap. And I have to include it in here because I get this question a lot as well. Talk about, oh, it's CAMS, and there's somebody in the audience. Isn't it CALMS? Okay, that's the L. The L is lean. It's not necessarily part of DevOps, but it can make DevOps better, and DevOps can make lean better. So that's all I'm going to say on that. I mentioned earlier that there was something called the DevOps tool chain. It's often said in computer science there's a series of difficult problems, and one of those difficult problems is naming things. For example, DevOps is a terrible name because it's hard to name things. The DevOps tool chain continues to be a terrible name. It's neither a tool nor a chain. Okay? The DevOps tool chain is a manifestation of DevOps principles. We talked about the CAMS, and we sort of had a high-level philosophical talk about culture and automation and unlocking human potential, and that's all well and good, right? But when you're in the trenches, when you're actually the one in front of the computer trying to do things, talking about culture and talking about the value of human potential, that's not going to get your software deployed to production, all right? And that's where the DevOps tool chain comes into effect. It's a manifestation. It's a form of action. Okay, it's a way to describe, model, and ultimately take action within the context of DevOps principles. When somebody says they're doing the DevOps, what that means is they're implementing a DevOps tool chain. That's what doing the DevOps is. It's implementing a DevOps tool chain. Now, for those of you, and I've done this in front of people who are like really into DevOps, and I get a lot of flack over this definition, but follow me on this one, it works. Everybody's tool chain is different, all right? Because everyone's organization is different. Everyone's cultural values are different. Everyone's expectations are different. But they do follow a pattern, okay? The DevOps tool chain, as a manifestation of DevOps principles, follows a pattern. And the pattern looks a little bit like this. Good, that shows up okay. Everyone can read that? More or less? Okay, super. This could be a presentation on its own, and I've been to presentations on literally just this chart. Okay, so going through the whole thing, frankly, a little bit out of scope, but I do want to show it here, because you see it again, time and time again in DevOps literature, this sort of figure eight looking thing with the dev on one side and the ops on the other side. It's a pretty classic image over the last couple of years. There's one important thing to take away from this, and that is that the DevOps tool chain, and by extension DevOps itself, is a continuous cycle. All right? It doesn't have a place where it starts and a place where it finishes and everybody wraps their hands and goes home. It keeps going. All right? There's no start, there's no end. Well, there is a start and there is an end, but then it just loops back. It's a fluid movement from one stage to the next. So just taking a look at here, on the one side, we've got, let's start with plan. Plan's a good place to start. Got a plan to do something, right? Of course, everybody here, you know, we're all excellent programmers, and we do all of our time in pre-prod, and we do all of our time doing mock-ups, and we all of our time doing like pseudo-programming, so that we actually sit down in front of our IDE, we write perfect software with no bugs right off the top. Of course. I mean, I know this about you. That's fine. And how do we do that? It's because we plan, right? We plan. Then we create. Then we move on to verifying. Right? Trust, but verify. Trust, but verify. And QA, and testing, so on and so forth. Package is a funny term. Basically, it just means, you know, create deployables. Take that loose bits of perfect software that you've created and put it together in a way that you can put it on someone else's computer. Release it, configure it. You know, we can talk about Puppet or Chef or any sorts of things that you might be referring to. Monitor it, that's important, right? You gotta measure these things. So this is a cycle. And then once it's monitored and you're getting that data about what it is that it's doing, start planning again, right? It's a continuous cycle and everyone should be involved. Now there's one problem with this model, with this graphic. One problem. The silos are still there, right? We've got dev on one side and ops on the other. Now that doesn't mean everybody should be able to do all the jobs. That's impossible. Specialization is one of the really interesting things that the post-industrial world has allowed us to do, right? So you have specific areas of expertise, interest, et cetera, responsibility within your organization, it's fine. You don't have to do someone else's job. But the key element here is that sharing of information, right? The dev and the ops teams are working together. Now, this could be any teams, and it could be any steps. There could be marketing on one side and office of the CTO on the other. There could be who knows what, right? Academics on one side and students on the other. Medical professionals on one side, who knows, right? The whole idea is that it's a constant cycle of information and movement, fluidity, between disparate groups working together. And I know this sounds a little highfalutin, and again, you could have a presentation just on this. But the essential element here is the free flow of information. So, now what? Right? We've talked a little bit about what DevOps is, where it came from. We've used a lot of fun and interesting words. Cobus, how much time do I have left, buddy?
3 minutes.
3 minutes, Jesus. So where are we going? Well, you're going to take us to the future, right? DevOps is people, and your people, unless you're all synths. Refinement of this process into a formal business practice, further adoption and manifestation, public, private, academic spheres, development of new technologies through the lens of DevOps, right? Again, people driving the tools, not the other way around. Ultimately, it comes down to this. I'm a DevOps engineer, and you can too, right? DevOps is an ideology. One is a DevOps practitioner, right? You can't hire a DevOps. Spoiler alert, what is this in English? Fiche de paie. Pay stub literally says DevOps engineer on it. So, okay. It doesn't mean a coder or an infra hacker. It means somebody's responsible for shepherding and fostering DevOps principles within an organization. That's a DevOps engineer. Okay? That's what that means. And anybody can do it. Everybody can do it. In sort of a holy grail world of the perfect functioning DevOps organization, every single person in it is a DevOps engineer on top of whatever other stuff they're doing. Fair enough? Okay, great. So the last couple slides are I'm just going to put up, so as I promised, information. If you want to get your phones out or your notepads, hopefully you found this interesting. So there you go. Some additional reading, The 10 Myths of DevOps, I mentioned that Seth is a seminal blog post. It's kind of funny to read, and it introduces you to a bunch of the things that DevOps isn't. An intro to CAMS, which goes into a bit more depth than what I'm able to go into in a 30-minute slot here, okay? And two books, actual books. One is Effective DevOps, that's O'Reilly Press, released this year by Jennifer Davis and Catherine Daniels, aforementioned individuals. It's excellent. Focuses maybe a little too much on tooling and technology for my liking, but it is very, very good. And the DevOps Handbook, IT Revolution Press, Gene Kim, John Willis, some others, which doesn't focus enough on tooling and technology for my liking. So really, you need to read both, but they're excellent. Again, some of the people that I mentioned, definitely record these names, follow these people on Twitter. You can learn a lot from what they've written, a lot from going to see talks and presentations that they're doing, have really influenced me in my career and a lot of people in the industry. Some more on here as well. Catherine, excellent. Tweets a lot about beer, so if you're not into beer, maybe don't follow her Twitter feed. I did use some images that I did not create. So there we go. Don't have to take a picture of that. And and as I mentioned earlier, that's me. That's my Twitter handle. Hit me up. Follow me on Twitter. Hit me up on GitHub, okay? I love working on open source projects, so let's do something wonderful. I'm going to be around for the next few days. I'm going to do in the open spaces. Please come talk to me. I want to talk about DevOps. I want to talk to you. Thank you very much, everybody.